Welcome back to our series on objects of crisis. During this pandemic, we've decided to look into our collection and to find objects that inform us about how people in the past have tackled major crises, major experiences of threat, of danger, of a lethal threat, and how they've come on top of it, how they've prevailed, and sometimes how they've fought it. Today, it's my great privilege to welcome my colleague, Carl Heron, who's the head of the Center for Scientific Research at the British Museum. Carl, what is the object you have chosen? What is the story behind that object?
I want, through the lens of the British Museum, to explore the disease of smallpox, and in particular, some of the early interventions, some of the early approaches that were introduced in order to protect individuals from the ravages of the disease. Smallpox was endemic on the planet for hundreds of years, and the disease, even in the 20th century, it's been estimated that 300 million people died, at least 300 million people died from the disease of smallpox. And it's a disease which has been eradicated now. So in one sense, it's been one of the most important global health success stories. The World Health Organization declared that smallpox had been eradicated in 1980. The last case of smallpox was reported in the 1970s. So how does that impact on the British Museum? So the object that I've chosen is a report. And it's a report that was published by the Royal College of Physicians in 1806. And the title of the report is On the Cowpox, or cowpox as we would probably know it today, or vaccinations. And this was a report published on a single side of paper, just 21 short paragraphs, that was authored on the advice of Parliament and the Crown to report on the advantages and some of the risks and the benefits of vaccination. Now, vaccination was a new term. It had only been introduced several years previously. And it goes as follows. Vaccination appears to be, in general, perfectly safe. The disease occasioned by it is very mild, and it seldom prevents those under it from following their usual occupations. So at first glance, this is not an object of crisis. This is an object of well-being, of promoting human health, the safe method of protecting individuals from the ravages of smallpox. The reason why I think the report should be seen as an object of crisis is that it goes on to counter and condemn certain attitudes towards vaccination. It mentions the imperfect testimonies of the few opposers, the mistakes of ignorant men, and willful misrepresentation lessening the confidence in the safety of vaccination. The practice of vaccination had only just been introduced, and within a few years, the Royal College of Physicians felt compelled to prepare a report to try and counter an anti-vaccination stance.
And what had preceded vaccination? Was there any method that researchers and medical doctors had started to develop?
We can actually go back to Hans Sloane, who was responsible for the foundation of the British Museum. And he wrote an article in 1736, and it was called An Account of Inoculation. So there was a method prior to vaccination called inoculation. Specifically, it was called variolation, and that was specific to smallpox inoculation. And the article that he wrote in 1736 was very heavily influenced by Lady Mary Wortley Montagu, who had contracted smallpox herself in 1715. And she traveled to Constantinople. And in Constantinople, she witnessed this inoculation for smallpox taking place. And it was widespread throughout the Middle East, and India and China, but unknown in the West, so unknown in Britain. And she described in a letter And I shall just quote a little from the letter that she wrote in April 1717. There is a set of old women who make it their business to perform the operation. The woman comes with a nutshell full of the matter of the best sort of smallpox and asks what vein you please to have opened. She immediately rips open that you offer her with a large needle and puts into the vein as much matter as can lie upon the head of her needle. So this method of inoculation, variolation, was the direct transfer of smallpox, perhaps from one of those infected pustules, directly inserting that to a healthy individual. Now that would create a localized or mild infection in that individual. But the immune response, unknown at the time, of course, the immune response would cause a reaction and the body would fight that localized and mild infection and produce an immunity against yes. the full ravages of the disease.
It's a very interesting aspect of this that it's been a practice in, as you said, in the Middle East, in the Ottoman Empire, in India and China, widespread, but not in Europe. And that it took that moment of transfer of knowledge from a person who had suffered through this disease to a distinguished surgeon and scholar who would then publish this and make it known amongst the learned societies of his own region.
Yes, indeed. And so Lady Montague was very much responsible for bringing that to the attention. There were others, of course, there were other publications. In fact, Sloane's publication, his article, wasn't actually published until after he died. It was published mm-hmm. in 1755. But as physician to the crown, he had a very important role to play yeah. in advocating for inoculation throughout Britain.
What is the difference between inoculation and vaccination?
So for vaccination, we have Edward Jenner to thank in 1796, and he's called the father of vaccination. And Jenner was aware of a widely held belief that individuals with cowpox did not go on to contract smallpox. So cowpox was a disease that could be picked up through contact with cattle. So particularly milking of cattle, handling the udders, for example, one could contract cowpox. But cowpox is a very mild condition. It did lead to pustules on the hands, particularly around the areas of contact, but it was a very mild disease and it didn't transmit between humans. So there are very, very few people who had cowpox. Yeah. But what Jenner decided to do, rather than the direct insertion of smallpox matter into a cut arm, for example, he decided to take material, lymph or the infected pus from a cowpox pustule on the hand of Sarah Nelmes, the daughter of a farmer in Gloucestershire. Jenner was a country surgeon in Gloucestershire. Mm-hmm. He inserted the cowpox material into the arm of James Phipps, an eight-year-old boy. He then developed a mild infection through the cowpox, but Jenner, several weeks later, then inoculated by variolation smallpox into the same boy. And he did not go on to develop any infection whatsoever from the smallpox, however localized or mild. Jenner struggled to get his paper published. He eventually published it himself in 1798, and the practice was embedded. It became much more widely used after that date. But in 1806, the Royal College of Physicians was compelled to make these counter arguments against those who were opposed to vaccination.
And where would they, you know, where could we get hold of those, the arguments or the, let's say, the fears, the fantasies of those who were against vaccination?
The opponents to vaccination took on a number of different forms. There were some doctors were opposed to vaccination because they had been practicing variolation throughout their careers. So that was one. There were sanitation questions. This is in the days before sterilization, before mm-hmm. antibiotics. So there was certainly, in cases where there was carelessness or ignorance, there may be cross-contamination. Many of the vaccinations took place in smallpox hospitals, for example, where smallpox was rife. And therefore, there were concerns about the health status. But one of the points that the report makes, and it's paragraph 18, publications with prints and representations of diseases of a frightful and monstrous appearance have been of late widely circulated, and they have lessened the confidence of many persons in the safety and security of vaccination. One of the most famous is by James Gilray, and it's called The Cowpox or The Wonderful Effects of the New Inoculation. And it's a pretty awful scene. It shows an individual, a physician, and it's probably Edward Jenner, and he gazes rather dispassionately. He looks really disinterested as he cuts into the arm of a frightened-looking woman. And a boy to one side of Jenner holds a container, a bucket full of vaccine pock hot from the cow. And around this scene, so in the foreground and behind Jenner and the frightened-looking woman, are individuals who are already vaccinated. And from these individuals, from their arms and from other parts of their body, are sprouting cows.
It's rather brutal.
It is. And there are many of these, actually, that were in circulation at the time. According to one researcher of Gilray's satire, and again, a quote, he is simultaneously portraying the anxieties of the opponents of vaccination whilst ridiculing their ill-informed and histrionic ideas.
There is one aspect which we haven't really addressed here, and that might be interesting for our listeners. Smallpox was eradicated through vaccination. It didn't go away by itself. The Spanish flu, you said, if I remember correctly, Carl, mutated?
Yes.
Into something less virulent, less lethal.
Yes.
So these are two possible paths a pandemic can take.
Indeed. And the coronavirus, the genetic sequence is changing. So scientists have already been able to understand some genetic changes in the sequences between the early manifestation of coronavirus and some of the subsequent cases of where the virus has been sequenced. So it's RNA in the case of coronavirus. All influenza viruses are RNA. So it's changing, but we don't know what the impact of those changes are yet. It's too early to tell whether we might be, there might be mutations that lead to less virulent sources or indeed more virulent sources. We just don't know.
As a bioarchaeologist, the question of diseases and the spread of diseases and the question of how you can detect them is certainly a very important field of research.
But there's a really rich area for research, and museum collections will play a very significant role here in ancient pathogenic DNA and RNA, depending on the type of virus, but also bacteria, Yersinia pestis, responsible for the plague, bubonic plague, and ancient pathogen research into both DNA and RNA has come up with some spectacular findings from the bones and teeth of humans, from the human remains in the museum collections, but also from objects. So bioarchaeology will play an increasing role, and the museum collections that we have curated across the world will really inform our understanding of the evolution and the transmission of disease. It's an area for rich research potential.
Talking to you, Carl, has certainly helped me to understand those implications and the potential that those collections across the globe and the people working on those collections really hold in store for us and for future developments. So thank you very much indeed for sharing that with us. That's very illuminating. Thank you for listening. If you liked it, please subscribe. And if you can, please donate to www.britishmuseum.org/ donate. Thank you very much indeed.